Hello everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Manohar. I'm a software engineer at Esper. I'm a software engineer at Esper. So the title of the talk, we'll be discussing how goroutines work, and I'll try to answer the question of why the goroutines are so lightweight while they're working. Different language comes with different kind of features, and so Go also comes with many different kind of features. One such important feature that everyone likes is the way Go, the construct of how goroutine works and how it can be used so seamlessly with building concurrency tools. Not able to go forward and backward. Okay, so I'll take a simple program, simple C program, and try to, so every program when it tries to start, so it will set up a few things before it actually runs your piece of code. So I'll try to present what C does and what Go does so it has to set up a few things before it tries to provide all the features that it has to provide. So let's take a simple C program, simple Hello World C program, and try to compile it and see. Doesn't go forward. Should it be pointed somewhere? It should be pointed that direction. Okay. So I'll take a simple C program and try to compile it and try to analyze with C stress. So we'll see that there are only few things that a simple C program does that. So it will try to get your program into memory, and it will try to map a few memory regions for your program. So that's all a simple C program does. But whereas when you take a simple Go program and try to build it and try to run it, so it will do some setup. And so in doing so, it will do around 150 syscalls. Whereas if you take another program like Python, it will go around 500 syscalls and so on. So basically, when you compare with C and when you compare with Go, so it does some groundwork before it actually runs your piece of code. So I'm going to discuss what happens in this first few setup. And and I will try to apply those concepts to goroutine. So basically in these first few calls, it will try to set up. So Go uses something called Go runtime. It will try to spend all that initial time in setting up Go runtime. So most of the talk I'll be focusing on how Go runtime works, and what parts of Go runtime had made goroutine simpler. In Golang, functions are canonically used like goroutine. So through the documentation, functions are usually called as goroutines directly. So there is a little difference between goroutines and functions, but I won't be discussing those things today. But there is some difference, but I'll be calling functions as goroutines only. So Go runtime, it's not like virtual machine or JVM or any Beam or any kind of thing. It's just some group of processors that will try to try to allocate memory, try to do scheduling of the processes, and does some garbage collection. It's not a virtual machine, but it's just a group of processes that will try to schedule your Go routines properly. So the entire Go runtime contains three different structures. G's, M's and P's. I'll explain. So G's are basically means your go routine. So when you have piece of code to run, so your piece of code will be attached a G object to it. And when your code has run and executed it, it will be the code will be executed and G object will be written to a pool of G's. And so basically each go routine will be assigned a G object to it. And next we'll have M object. So each M means it's an OS thread. So ultimately your go routine will run on simple OS thread. And and there could be as many OS threads as possible that if the operating system allows. Usually the Linux system allows as many OS threads as possible. So you can get as many M's as possible. And so the last structure is P. So this is usually obtained during when the runtime is initialized. It usually get this number of processors that the system has. So in the initial syscalls that I told, right? So in that, one of the syscalls is to get the number of processors that this system has, and will get that variable and will try to initialize a Go max proc environment variable. So the P is proportional to P will be equals to number of Go max proc. So you shouldn't over allocate this Go max proc. I'll tell in the next slide why. So what happens if you over allocate the number of P's? So the number of, so if you set the Go max proc environment variable, the number of P's will be assigned automatically. So these are the three main structures which will be used to build the entire runtime. Also, one important thing is that the scheduler and the garbage collector both are written in C, and they will be running as separate. They will be running in separate stacks, as I told earlier. So this is an explanation from that blog which is written over there. So basically, we have a global list, global queue of G's, and for each processor, there will be a local queue of G's. So at any given point of time, only one M will be assigned to a particular processor, and one OS thread will be running on a particular OS, one particular processor. So when a G come, so the Go scheduler will pop an item from the queue, and it will try to assign to one of the OS thread, and it will try to execute that. So the important thing to note over here is that once a G has been assigned to M on a particular P, so it is never rescheduled to another processor. So this is one of the design of the Go scheduler. So if a particular processor has emptied its own list of G's on local, it will try to fetch it from other processor's queue, and it will try to assign to this processor. So this way, if it has assigned to this processor, then those will execute on this one, this particular P2 only. So if the local queues has emptied, it will try to fetch the G's from the global queue. So as I told earlier, if you over allocate P's, what happens is that, so if you over allocate P, so each process will be, each G will be assigned to particular M and P, and if you over allocate P, and the system doesn't have those many OS processors to do that, it won't share with other processors, it will directly go into infinite loop. It will try to execute that on that processor only, but there is no such resource for it to do. So it will try to stuck in an infinite loop if you over allocate Go max procs. So now that we have discussed So for a Go routine, how it is scheduled, and let's also discuss how the stack of that Go routine will also set up. For every function, for every Go routine which comes in, it will be assigned a fixed a stack size which starts with as small as 2 kilobytes, and so there will be stack guards in the runtime. So the stack guards will detect if there is an overflow. So if the process keeps using more memory, the runtime will detect that this particular stack has overflown. So when the runtime detects that, it will stop the time and it will immediately move this particular. It will try to create a new OS, a new stack which is double the size, and will try to move everything to that stack. It will also make sure that pointers are also moved properly. And it also creates something called system stack, and it will also create something called signal stack. Both system stack and signal stacks are assigned to per OS thread. As I told earlier, so there will be G's where your code will be running on, and so each G's will have their own user stack. So that is where they will be assigned a fixed number of stacks, and if it overflows, it will be assigned a new stack. So along with that, it will also have something called system stacks and signal stacks. So much of the syscalls when it tries to do initialization has been spent setting up these stacks also. So the system stack, so the Go runtime, when it has to run a particular piece of code which does not need to be preempted, it will try to switch those tasks and will try to move those tasks to these particular types of stacks. And the signal stacks usually used for error handling. And yeah, to answer the final question, why are they so lightweight? So one of the reason is that the stacks, when it has been initialized, usually the other operating system usually starts with the stack size, the fixed amount of stack size, but this one actually starts with a small stack size and grows and shrinks as needed. And the second reason is that the scheduler, as I told, the processor will always be assigned a particular OS thread, and it will always keep running. It will never terminate that thread. So the overhead to bring down a thread and bring up a thread is not there. So the runtime will make sure that there is less overhead to bring down and bring up a thread. So when a new G comes, it will try to assign to a running OS thread which is already running on that processor. So this way it will make sure that ultimately it runs on OS thread, and it will try to make sure that there is as less overhead to bring up and bring down a thread as possible. So for those reasons, Go routines are so lightweight. Yeah, that's all. Questions? Yes. Yes, I've tried.
Guys, sorry, guys. Nobody, if you don't mind, you can repeat your question.
I've actually tried over allocating Omax procs to, like, let's say 100 or something on a 4 CPU machine, and it never goes into an infinite loop. Like, the program still runs fine. Although it gets slower, but it still runs fine. So, like, what happens there?
I did some example. So it went into an infinite loop.
Okay. So one thing that he mentioned was that you should not over allocate GoMax procs to, like, more than the available process P's essentially. So in my machine there were like four virtual cores essentially, and I allocated it to max procs to, let's say, 100 or something like that, and the program still ran fine actually.
So it will run fine, But if you exceed, if your Go routines exceed to that many levels, that many Go threads, I mean, Go routines, then it will run into infinite loop. So if you try to spin up 100 Go routines, which it will support, then it will run into infinite loop.
No, actually the Go routines were like more like, okay. Yeah, actually I was using the, Go routines were still, limited. Like the max proc was higher, but the Go routines were still limited. So I think that's why I probably it ran.
Yes. That could be the reason, but, Ankur, you would like to add something?
Okay, you should not be running. There are various factors that constitute the P, right? So there are scenarios you should not be doing more than the number of processors, then the logical processor should not exceed the number of cores. One thing is you all have heard C10K problem, right? The main idea behind the logical processor is to avoid C10K problem. Your CPU should not be, means your process should not be doing too much switching based on the thread. So if you exceed logical processor, there are two scenarios that comes into picture. First thing, first and foremost thing, for every logical processor that you create, garbage collection times gets up. Means if you have four logical processor, let's
and
think
garbage
this
collector will use some of them. Yeah.
Yes, but it has to scan all the P's in the stop phase. So that stop phase, it has to context switch and your stop the world time will go up. Second thing is while doing work stealing, it has to scan all those P's also to check where the stealing has happened. Yeah. From where I have to steal. And since only four, let's suppose you have a four thread only, I mean four logical CPU core. In that case, if you have hundreds of P's, it has to first garbage collection has to scan all the 100 P's. Yeah. By doing context switch. P also for work stealing also you have to do all the 100 P's. Those are the two of the some scenarios. The reason for introducing logical P's is this. Plus you get all because. If you think P's is not simply a logical processor, it maintains so many caches, it maintains local 32 kilobytes caches for a small object. It maintains the list of for every P, you have a local queue up to 56, right? Where the Go routines are put. So it has to scan all those Go routines. Otherwise it cannot perform garbage collection. Yeah. At any point of time.
So always the number of Go max proc that it gets during the first syscall, it will always be less than what the system already has. So for my machine, it has 12 cores and the Go max proc that I got is 8.
So, okay. So for Go max, by default, I think the number is 256. You cannot exceed more than 256 Go max proc. That's why one of the reason your process might be in the infinite loop, your process might be hanged straight.
Okay. Yeah. So your program might need lesser number of programs and you want to send it during runtime. So if you want, so it, yeah.
Are available.
Yes,
to the operating system, because end of the day it is the operating system which is going to submit the Go routines into different threads.
Yes.
To the processors, right? Processing cores basically. So my question was, why at the why we need to, you know, even allocate or dictate the value of the Go Max procs at the first place?
Yeah, sometimes you might need. So sometimes in the runtime, so you want to set up, you want your application to use. So in such cases, you can set that environment variable in the runtime.
Okay, and what if I don't set up the number?
If you don't set up, it will directly take a default value based on your number of cores.
No, but in that case, do you see any performance degradation or anything, any chance of any issues if I don't, allocate or mention the number of cores or the Go Max procs value?
So the runtime will know what's best for the application. So based on that, it will try to allocate the max proc less than the number of cores that the system has. So runtime will understand what's best for the application.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, exactly. So I think the runtime automatically takes all of the cores available, and that becomes the piece, I think.
To just answer your question, why we need piece, right? It's basically related to the scheduling things. If you have, let's suppose, 1-into-1 threading, right? We all know 1-into-1 threading model, right? You have a user space function that gets modeled on the number of threads. Again, the C10K problems comes into picture, right? You cannot, you will be facing the thread pool and all those things, right? Why? Because if you have more number, let's suppose the time slice of each thread is 10 milliseconds, right? For the given 10 millisecond, you want your work to be done, right? It's for 10 milli, if I have 10,000 threads running on my single CPU, it will, the CPU will exhaust its time doing the context switching instead of doing the real work. That's why you want to limit the number of actual threads. Now, the same problem, if you do not have user level thread, like 1-to-1, this problem is very much evident. Second thing is, let's suppose we have a user space thread in threads, means we have lots of threads, user green threads or go routine, and we map to the n number of threads without the logical processor P. What is the second problem we have? First problem is that even though we have limited the number of the actual number of CPU threads to, let's suppose, 100, the second problem is, what happens if our CPU thread is in the system call? It's very much right. This can happen, right? In the real world, most of the socket operations are socket system call, right? So how do you deal with such scenarios? Then again, you are spinning more threads. The same problem continues, right? So third thing is, when you have these many, when you don't have this logical processor, again, by the design of how do you do garbage collection, from where do you steal? If I don't have logical processor, I have spun up hundreds of the CPU thread. I have to actually scan for stealing all those 100 threads, right? All those 100 threads to find out where actually I need to. Let's suppose in worst case scenario, only 2 thread has the real work to do. That means only 2 thread that has this go routine available, and somewhere the 9 thread want to, it has to scan all the thread to find out, and in the worst case, it will find that in the last. So in those scenario, that's why you design 3 level of scheduler. That means you want these scanning from where go routine to be scanned, how many all these things to be scanned for, again, the cache coherency problem, caching of the small object to be for in a limited set of processor. Like, that's why the value, this concept of logical processor came altogether, the P, right? This constitute the three level scheduling. You have a scheduling goroutine put into the locals and queue, getting scheduled by the P on the CPU threads. So changing this, changing the value of means benchmark it. I would say first benchmark it. Don't assume that, okay, this is performance issue. This is going to degrade it. If you say performance issue, I can ask you, what is the number you are seeing for the throughput? What is the drop in the throughput? Where exactly the performance is? Is this due to the logical processor or your code? Are your code in the system call? Where exactly the performance is? Logical processor, saying logical processor will have performance impact or not? It's, you cannot have this general notion, right? It depends upon various other factors. So almost try to, there is famous quotes, right? First benchmark it, if there is performance, do not optimize prematurely. So those are the other value that also constitute to that. Apart from that, yes, you can control the P, but I don't think you are getting any real benefit. If you degrade it, you are getting less parallelism. If you are increasing it, you are not getting more parallelism, honestly. If my parallelism is the longest unit of work that I have a 4-thread, right? I have a Fibonacci number. I divided those number into, okay, on one thread, I will calculate Fibonacci for these four numbers. Fibonacci 10, Fibonacci 3, Fibonacci 2, Fibonacci 1. The Fibonacci 10, that's the time that Fibonacci 10 takes, that is the parallelism at max. If Fibonacci takes 10 unit of time to calculate, and all those takes 1 unit of time to calculate, your parallelism is still 10, right? Because until unless all the four works is done, you cannot proceed further. So you are reducing the parallelism the same way. If you increase the P, you are reducing the parallelism the same way, because again, the P has to be context switched, right? It cannot detect that there are lots of other mechanisms for CPU to say, this is the hot thread, I will not context switch it. So think about these things also before you manipulate P. There is reason, there is a reason for Go developer to put hard coded number, like number of P, by default, I will spin this many, because I get the max value of parallelism also along with the concurrency. I hope these answers some of the question people might have.
So you mentioned the user stacks, right? So each goroutine gets a user stack. But how, like, where are the channels allocated? Like, what stack are channels allocated in? What stacks are channels allocated in? Go channels, yeah. It's not allocated in any stack?
Okay, yeah. So you mentioned default Go max procs, right? So it's number of processors or something. So how does running this in say with C group settings? You know, in Docker you can restrict the number of computing, the CPU cycles available or something. So how does that affect Go max procs? So does it change when you run it in an unconfined manner or when you jail it?
It depends upon the C group that Docker, that particular container has received. So if that CPU, it depends on percentage that you specify in the C group. So
if I specify, say, only
50%,
yeah. So 50%,
then you will be getting only half of what you have.
Okay, so if the number of actual processors was 4, it will make it 2.
So, and if you specify 2 in your C groups, if you specify 50% in your C group, then you will be giving 2 processors for that container.
Mm-hmm.
And Go max proc will behave accordingly.
Okay.
Made sense?
Yeah.
So anyone else know the answer of where channels will be allocated? In heap?
Yeah, there are some global heap chain structure.
Okay. Okay, thanks. I hope what I told made sense. Thanks.
Thanks, Manohar.
So you have to, you connect to the Zoom.
Meanwhile, his settings.
Do you have any questions regarding what the? Taken care by the right function, right? That's where the abstraction comes into picture. If you are not using interface, I don't know the context in which you are talking about, but most of it, yes, but most of the time you do not use interface just for the testing purpose. You use it for the abstraction. There is a term for the, there is a region abstraction is there. You do not have to worry about the implementation details. All you need to do is write a dot write. How it is writing? As a library, like, CLI can read from read the content from three parts. I mean, three sources. So it can be a key value source like HC, or it can be a file like a YAML file. So it can be from class. So I can write an interface called parser, and this parser can have three implementations. It reads from flags, reads from file, and reads from a key value source like HC. So the user doesn't have to know which like the implementation detail is given. So in future, let's say we have another data source, we can easily make sense. You have this additional problem of handling partial failures over the network. So that is something that, like, it's something different from the leading process.
So you're telling that even when you're running locally, running as a test
distribution. Yeah, we are ready for the second talk. Hello, my name is Gaurav Thogia, and I'm an intern at Amazon. So before we get started, I just want to make a little lay of the land. So raise your hand if you do not understand, but this. Yeah, so. Okay. Raise your hand if you do not understand what disk imaging is, or what file headers are, or what file structures are. Okay, wait. So, as you can see, this the topic of today's topic is file carving. File carving is in recovering deleted files. Well, that is one of the use cases. But are other things we will see that. Okay, so what does it really mean to carve out a file? Okay, at times during forensic investigations, we need the data that the user has deleted. Now, this user could be our suspect or some other person of interest. By carving, I mean we are picking out the file which have been deleted. Well, they have been sort of deleted, as in they're on the system, they're on the drive, they just have not been indexed. When we delete a file, only a pointer is moved, right? So the file is actually just there. It's on the drive. It's sitting right there. It's just that we're not pointing to it. Imagine that you have a book. Okay, it has an index, but we have 10 chapters. Someday, I take that book, I tear off the index page, I add a new index page, and remove fifth and sixth chapters and their page numbers. Someone who might want to read the book, open the index page and see, okay, fifth and sixth chapters are not here. They're not in the book. Unless, of course, they actually do go to those page numbers, you know, by going through the entire book and find that, yeah, these pages are there. So that's essentially how this file grabbing works. This is not limited to deleted files. You could carve up files from, say, a network transaction. Okay, you have two computers and the data stream through them. Or just imagine an organization. So many packets are going through. You have a sensor that collects all the data, aggregates them, and then saves them in a PCAP file. Simple use case. Now, since these files are not saved, but they will structure, you know, they're not saved in the file system, you have to carve them out of the PDF file. Or another use case, you have a log file. And this log file you receive from an alert from a SIEM solution or whatever security solution that you have in place, that some malicious data was transferred under the hood, you know, in this log file. You take that log file, carve out the data, it could be some movie or movie studio, and someone tried to pirate the movie by sending the log file and embedding the video file inside. So that is another use case. Of course, there are more, but let's just move on. If you have any questions at any point of time or anything, and if you feel like I'm saying anything wrong, just interrupt me and mention them. Okay, so why carve files? The perspective that I'm taking here will be from a digital forensic investigation. Most of the time, or rather, in my experience, maximum time, you will need those deleted files because that's where the real evidence lies. You get a computer, you make a disk image out of it. Now, disk image is the bit-to-bit replica, all the accessible spaces of that drive. Now, I'm using the term accessible here because there are some places which cannot be accessed by the operating system within the hard drive. It could be DCOM or host-protected areas or other places. And we have specialized hardware for that. But say if you are a small company that cannot afford Tableau or forensic files or those hardware devices, you'll be using, say, Autopsy or whatever software to get the disk image down. But it would be an almost exact replica of the hard drive. You get the disk, right? Now what to do? Now you try to parse the file system to get all the files. Okay, good. But that's just all the files that are already that have not been deleted, or that or the user hasn't attempted to, you know, sort of hide them from the investigators. Now the ones that have been deleted, it could be images, Word documents, executables, or whatever. You need to carve those files out of the file system so you can perform further investigation. Now, the point is, now you might ask, how do we actually carve these files? And we have a number of methods, some which we'll see in the next slide. Okay. So, more traditional and basic ones include this header, footer based ones. So, we have a file, right? Almost every file will have a header. A header is the signature of the file. For example, for the JPEG file, the header is JFIL. Okay, and there's a footer of the file. In most common types like JPEG, PNG, PDF, or some video files or executable files, they will have a header and a footer signifying the starting and the ending of the file. You might be getting where I'm going with this, right? We we take the disk image. It's a simple flat file. It's a binary file. It doesn't have file system. We're not going for that at all. We're reading the raw bytes or the hex values. We start reading it from the starting linearly, and as we reach this pattern of bytes, okay, that is the header. If at any point you get confused with this algorithm, that is fine. We'll see it in action. Okay, we find that pattern of values. Okay, this should be one after the other. Most of the times it's just four bytes, one after the other, in the beginning of the file. So that's their header. We start copying the file. Where do we stop? We stop when we match the footer signature. We find the footer signature, we stop copying. Then we look for more files that match the signature. That's a header footer method. Header footer method has another variation, that is for the header and the size method, maximum size method. At times, some music files like AVI, I believe, does not have a footer. Okay, so what do you do then? How do you get that file? You find the header, but you don't have the footer. So it's sort of a game of statistics here. We have a pretty good understanding of how big a specific video file could possibly be. So we guess their maximum size and we carve until then. And we get some good accuracy. I mean, there are algorithms like Photorec Carver, and that works very well. So it uses these methods. Yeah. Yes, that is a great question. So now we have fragmentation types. I'll take all the cases here. First case, the file is not fragmented at all. That is great for us. We get the file copied using the metadata explain. Now, second case is bifragmented. Now, for the bifragmented method, again, we guess how much the gap could possibly be between the first part and the second part. We try to either skip that gap, or then in the method I'm going to show, it's not going to cover that case. It will just ignore it and copy the red gap as well. Then we have the third case, that is the multi-fragmented file. There will be multiple parts. So the algorithm will try to guess the amount of fragmented portion in number of fragments of the file. And according to Vicky and Reddit's on forensic PK, they said that in most of the cases, that would be like around 75% of the cases, it would be the case of bifragmented, and rest would be multi-fragmented. There's a research paper associated with that as well. I'm not going to link it here because I made it in a hurry, but later I'll share the resources. Okay, so is this clear? Or, then, okay, so moving on. Now we have the file structure based one. It will take into account multiple factors, which will include header and footer. There will be the size and how do different types of files are generally there. Like what kind of characters would, what kind of hex values would a PDF file would generally contain, or like what kind of characters would a Word document contain? It's essentially an archive, right? So that's how this file structure based will work. Then we have the content-based one. It looks at the frequency of different hex values of a certain file. It doesn't look at headers and footers of the file to figure out what type of file that is. And finally, we have the hash-based ones. This is not an exhaustive list. There are other methods out there. So hash-based ones, they use essentially a database of block on hashes of blocks. Now these blocks are a bunch of bytes that they have hashed, and they have a database of these hashes. They try to match it with the hashes of the file that they're trying to carve. And if those hashes match, then they carve the file.
One question.
Yes.
First of all, the header and footer page, is it basically generally like a binary file? Or is it like a binary file like a audio file, right?
As in the source file or the one we're trying to carve?
Yeah, the source file.
Source file can be anything. It could be a file, it could be a flat file, a DD file, or some other disk format. It could be any file. So we're being very generic. It doesn't have to be any specific format.
Can the
header for the method we use for the deleted file?
Yes.
But for a deleted file, what's the header we use?
No. In my experience, that header footer method has worked. Autopsy uses it, and Case uses it. Autopsy is just an open source forensic software, and Case is a commercial.
So is it hash based?
Yes.
So is it hash based once easy to defeat because you just change one byte or something and that's gonna change the hash. So when you're trying to match your isn't that very easy to defeat?
I haven't tested a scenario, but now I guess I will.
Okay. I think the event like only some parts of the hash.
Sometimes.
You hash like some parts of the whole file, and you only match those. You not hash the entire file.
Yes, yes, then.
Okay.
So we have a big file. We have when I mentioned the blocks. So suppose we have a 1 GB file, out of which we have 10 MB. Files. Each 10 MB file will have a number of hashes associated with them. So we say a block of 20 bytes, a block of 10 bytes, and we get hashes of those, and we have a database of similar things. And we try to match those hashes, and then using that, we cut the file. We don't hash the entire file, but yes, of course, as we explained, that would make it easy to defeat this.
Okay, so there's no sort of rule out of probabilistic.
Yes. Okay, so it's time for demo, and I'll show you some code that will be using the header footer list file tagging method to carve out GIF files. We'll be using a classic scenario of Rhino case. This was presented in DFRWS. So it's the case is available online. You can simply download the file and try to use different methods to carve out files. It's a case of poaching, essentially. It's a fake case, so it was a forensic challenge. So should I increase the font or is it visible? Just let me know when to stop. I think it should be visible now. Okay, so it's a pretty basic algorithm. I'm just taking the source file here. I get the size of the file, and then I open the file in video. Then I find this function. I'm seeking it to zero position because just in case if the file has been read before. I know it hasn't been, but while I was testing it, there were some problems. Then I make a buffer size of just 1 byte because I'll be reading byte by byte. So I start reading the file from the beginning to the end. Then, okay, before I continue, I need to explain this counter part here. This counter will help in essentially matching each byte. I need to make sure that suppose
A, B, C, D are the bytes that I need, are the values that I need to match. I have value A, I match it first, I increase the counter. Then I look for value B. If I find the value B, I increase the counter to 2. If I do not, then I roll back the counter to 0. Then I start again, because these values have to be in a certain sequence. And that's just all what this switch case is doing. Okay, so I'll just go there. So for the first case, for this GIF file type, the first case is the hex value of 0x89. So if you find this value, then we increase the counter, as I explained before. Now the next case is supposed to be 0x50. If the next value, the second value is this, if it matches, then we increase the counter again. Otherwise, we simply reset the counter. Also, notice the fact that I'm appending it to this curve value. This means that I am copying the file while matching it. So basically, if it matches, copy. If it doesn't match, then reset the counter and start matching again. So I do this until I reach 0xAE, which is the end of the header. At this point, if the header does not, if this value does not match, I simply copy it, because header is over. It's the middle part of the file now, which needs to be copied. It doesn't have to match anything. When the middle part is copied, we reach the end of the file, that is the footer, and then we start the counter again. Now at this point, we're trying to match the tail of the file here. All right. So if the byte matches, we increase the counter. If it does not, we decrease the counter by 1. Again, not setting it to 0, because otherwise it will go all the way back to the header. Again, so first case matches. First case of the tail matches, we copy it, increase the counter. If it does not match, we decrement, and we still copy it, because we are copying the middle of the file here. We go for the second case. If it matches, we increase the counter, we copy. If it does not, then we go 2 steps back, because we need to pattern match the entire pattern of the tail. Same scenario with the last piece of the tail. And when we have reached the end, we write the file and simple. And I'm just getting a random image name here, and then I save the file. Are there any questions at this point for this, anything at all? Okay, I'll explain. So you understood that we have matched the header now, and now we're copying the middle of the file. Now we reach the tail of the file. Okay, suppose this, the position I'm standing here right now, is the middle of the file. The next phase is the tail of the file. I'll just stand there so everyone can see. Okay, again, same situation. The position where I'm standing right now, this is the middle of the file. We have copied the header, we have matched on that. In the middle of the file, we're copying it. We need to find the tail. How do we find the tail? Tail has 3 bytes that needs to match. First byte, we match. It is indeed a match. We have increased the counter, we have copied it. Second byte, we need to match. It's not the correct match. It needs to be in a sequence. So we go back. Okay, we're still copying the middle of the file. Why did we go back? Because we need to match the tail in the exact same sequence. So if you're matching, say, values 1, 2, and 3, we match 1, it matches. We match 2, it doesn't match. It has to be 1, 2, 3. So we go back. All right. Do you understand? Is it clear? Okay, great.
I have a question.
Yes.
So can you just repeat? So because you're going byte by byte, right? If the content which is in the middle of the file, if it so happens to be the same 3 bytes as what you're expecting in the end of the file, then won't your parser prematurely stop at that point?
So that is one of the caveats of this algorithm. Since I have not seen the situation yet, and the assumption is made, if this pattern ever comes, then it's just the tail of the file. So that's why these are called magic strings or magic numbers, if you've heard of them. So what's magical about them is that they should be in specific places, that being footer being at the tail, header being in the beginning. Of course, someone could modify a file, a skilled criminal could modify a file and make a pattern like this in the middle of the file, so it will be difficult for us to carve it out. But that's just another edge case that we could take into account while writing our algorithm. Okay, so I'll just run it now, and I'll show where I'm running it on. Okay, as I explained, I'll be running it on the Rhino case. It's a log file. And it's not opening. It is a log file, it doesn't have, it might have some images, it might not. We're here to find whether we have, whether there are some images there or not. And this output directory is empty right now. Okay, so it does indeed have some GIF files. Also, this program will work on Windows, Mac, Linux, or whatever machine where Go can run, because we are not really concerned about file system at all. Again, we're going below that. We're just reading a flat file. We're reading it byte by byte. We're matching those magic values, and we're carving out the files that do match the criteria. So we have these images. Yes. Of course, we could run it on the DD file to get more images, and hopefully they will be a little bit bigger. So I'll just remove this directory and make a new one and run my algorithm there in the DD file. DD file is just a disk image of a USB that they found, which that was the scenario that they presented in DFRWS. It will take some time to run on it. And I'm not actually sure whether it does have any GIF images or not, so there's a possibility that we might not find anything at all there. So while it's running, I'll take some more questions, or if you have any other ideas about how we could approach this problem, then that would be great as well. Yes, that is correct. So this is encrypted. You have to decrypt it first, because that the bytes will be different. If it's encrypted, you cannot get the data. Also, if you would like a more practical demonstration, you can just bring the USB device. We could add some images there, we could delete them, and we could try running it there. So that would validate this algorithm a little more. Okay, so looks like we have found some images there. That's nice. Okay, so this is one of the cases where the file might be fragmented or might not have been carved correctly. So this process will take some time. In the meantime, I could take some more questions in or around file carving. In such cases, when we have large files, so okay, in such cases, when you have large files, is it possible to use any concurrency concepts to make it possible? Okay, yes. So if we have a large file, we could sort of read that file in chunks. So suppose we have 10 gigabytes of file, that is the disk image that we have acquired, which is not a real scenario. Okay, we have 1 terabyte of file. Usually when we go to a suspect's place, we see their computer. The computer will be at least 1 terabyte or 2 terabyte of hard drive, right? So when we acquire that, we get a single file. We could read that file in chunks, and each chunk could work independently as a goroutine. Now, the problem here comes is that suppose in the chunk we have half of the file, and the other chunk we have other half of the file. How do we carve that out? In that case, we don't carve it using the header footer method. Use either the content based method or the hash based method. At times, we need to know what is the target file that we are looking for, which means we need to know what is the case here. Are we acquiring a malware infected computer? Do we know what type of file within the specific malware will be? Suppose there's a malware that packs its executables using, say, UPS or whatever method, and then deletes the files, right? So we are looking for those specific files. We know how the signature of UPS files, we can get the log hashes of that file and carve them off using concurrency. Because we'll be reading the file in chunks, so it will take 2 now.
Can you explain about the packages here?
Yes, yes. So the first one I use it to just generate the random name for the file. I didn't have to go overkill with this crypto random library, but it was just easy to use, and I didn't want to think too much about it. And then this encoding, I actually used it. Yeah, right. I used it where I was generating the random, when I was generating the random file name. Because I was generating random names, I had to convert them into string. Would you please go
to the.
Yeah, please. And format to simply print things out. And IO and IO return to for IO operations. OS I used for reading the raw bytes. Before this, I was using that Unix library that uses native Unix APIs and APIs. But then I later realized I was becoming a little too specific, so I changed and I realized that OS has a package that that is more cross-platform and helps in reading the raw bits and bytes. Then we have file path. I use it to split. Split the file path, or just in case if I provide a file path that's too long and I need to find that specific file name, if I'm not providing the file name, it's just for my convenience. So is that clear now? Yes.
It is
correlated 90% or 92%. So will it be possible to find out on that test?
Okay, so I understand your scenario that like you have a disk, but the size that you're assuming of the disk. Yeah?
Let's say suppose if I have 500 GB, or for making it easy, let's say 1 GB. So if during the decryption, if halted at like 90% or 95%, will it be possible to carve the data out of 90% which is being decrypted and like the 10%, I mean, I'm not sure how the data is getting scattered. So is it possible to carve that size out?
Okay, so I'm going to make two assumptions here. First assumption would be when the file is 90% decrypted, that 90% data is readable and we have access to it. Otherwise, when the rest 10% is still encrypted. Second assumption would be suppose if input the file as hash of the 90% of the file has not changed, which should not change. We have a file 1 GB encrypted. It's encrypted. So the correctness property of encryption algorithm state that the outputted file must not be modified or changed in any way. Right. So that means we will still have the same pattern that we did before we encrypted the file. So that in that way, suppose the 90% of the file is encrypted, we can indeed use different file carving methods to carve out the file, and that will work.
And if suppose the one file is scattered between the 90% and the 10%,
and then that is, I believe, becomes a game of statistics and probability. Okay, so looks like we're done. Let's see if we have found any files. Okay, so looks like we have found a file, and it is a rhino. It's one of the evidences that you need to find within the case. 8 more are there. Some are in log files, some will be in another format, some will be fragmented. So that's the need if you want to play on DFRWS, and they have the entire situation explained here. That was our demo. Hey, on the demo, anything about it? Okay then. Yes, I was using the header and footer parameters for demo. Yeah. Okay. I know this slide is a little bit redundant, but I just want to make sure that you understand it. Okay, then great. Thank you. And I am looking for a job. So, if you could just note down my contact, then great. Thank you. Thanks, Gaurav. So we have just finished 15 minutes ahead of time. We're going to take a small break after this.
Just to while Chris is setting up things, I just want to take some time to let you guys know about some of the things that we've been doing at GoLive Magnet. One of the early initiatives which we've been doing for the last 6 months is to allow participants to just come up on stage and talk for 2 minutes if they would like to pitch about their company or any job openings that they have. And this is open to all of you. And from this month onwards, we've started another initiative where we share a slide deck, and companies are free to populate that slide deck with any job openings that they have. And the contact points and things like that. Basically, this is just to allow those people who are not part of the GoLive community but also are involved in hiring. For example, HR, hiring managers and so on, who might not be on Meetup platform. There's an opportunity to allow them also to contribute to this. So there are some slides, there's some openings here. We'll just keep the slide live. Please feel free to have a look at it. I think all the contact information and all other details are also available here. So if you're interested, do make a note and do get in touch. So this is what we do. Free. We're not charging anybody for this sort of thing. So please make use of this opportunity. Also, if you feel in the companies that you work at, if there are openings which you think would probably get visibility by putting it here, please talk to people in your HR or the hiring manager and so on. Get touch with us to have this content here. We're likely going to roll this content every month. So whatever the newest set of openings that we get, we're going to keep posting this in each of the meetings. So here's someone from the Razor Cream would like to speak.
Also, guys, if you have any question regarding this job openings, do feel free to reach to us. Even though means we are not directly, means for SAP Lab, I am directly associated with it because I work for SAP Lab. But even we will be posting this slides on the meetup. So we don't, if you feel there is some misinformation or anything in the slides, do also reach to us and inform us regarding that. But we cannot verify it in every job.
Hey everyone. So glad to see so many people turn up on Saturday mornings. How's it? Hope you had a good time so far. Hope you had a good fun with your two talks that have been there. I understand that it's almost time for a break and you probably want to get up. I'll just be quick. So how did you like the venue so far? Okay, good. Hope you like the snacks and I believe there's actually some more food out there. In the meanwhile, just to give a brief introduction, my name is Giri, I'm with Razorpay, and I've been working here for quite some time now. This is Rathan, he's been working here for at least 2 years or so. More than 2 years. And the reason we are interested in hosting the GoLive Meetup is primarily get to know the community. To be fair, we hope to do this more often, and hopefully we can get some more meetups hosted here as well. We do run a large number of GoLive services in production for quite some time now, and we have vested interest in seeing the community grow and stay vibrant as such. So yeah, I won't go for anything more than that. In case you're interested in trying to find out what are sort of things that we do here with respect to GoLive, we can talk about this, have this and keep going on. And that's about it for now, guys. So, yeah, that's about it for my side. I didn't know this job or anything was going to be a thing. So, we do have openings for people working in GoLive. That's a separate tab altogether. We can talk about it. All right. GoLive is. Considering we're moving a large number of our microservices to GoLive, that's one big thing as such. And considering this audience is sort of targeted towards it, I think it makes sense just to mention the GoLive part. But yeah, if you are interested in doing any of this group, reach out and we can talk. Cool. Thanks. So in case, so the career page does exist, and if you want to reach out personally as well, you can just feel free to drop a mail to giri@lazypay.com and we can catch up. Alright, cool. Thanks again.
Thanks, Giri. Thanks, SLP, for hosting us.
So, good morning, everyone. My name is Shivraj. Before I speak about this opportunity, let me thank the host, Razorpay team, and the GoLang meetup organizers to give this opportunity. So, this is my first meetup at GoLang, and I'm really enjoying the sessions. Both the sessions were very useful. I work as a principal consultant. So, while planning to attend this meetup, I had a discussion with our HR team, and I got to know that there are some things. So, I'm not part of the hiring team myself. I'm a techie, like all of you. But yes, the requirement, I hope all of you know about Tech Mahindra. Is there anyone who needs an introduction about Tech Mahindra? Okay, we are part of the Mahindra Group and we are ranked in the top five among the IT companies in India. We have a presence globally in about 90 countries and we are about 1,30,000 odd strong at the moment. So we are, as you know, we are a services company. We work with many other companies. So this is actually for one of the top logistics company in the world. I cannot divulge the name of the customer, unfortunately. But so we are looking for GoLang developers with who have exposure in developing distributed systems and some other skills as well, which are listed here. So this is the URL where you can check out this information. And I'll be here. I have a colleague of mine who's also here. He is one of our practice heads. So if anyone is interested, please get in touch with us after the session. We'll be glad to share more information. In case you want to directly apply, that's the email ID to which you can send your profile. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. We will be taking a short break. After that, we will have our talk. So while in breakout, the snacks is available over there. So we will be here by 20.
I'm sharing my this right screen.
You can put your over your because
no, it's not coming. I should I stop it.
No, no, it's coming.
Yeah.
You're not connected.
Yeah, yeah, that I'm doing. Yeah, this is it, right? Just administration. Check it, cool. Can I just speak on the mic?
Disturb your networking session. So today we are going to talk about fundamentals of string theory. I hope you are aware that we are going to have this session today. Were you aware of it? Okay, obviously. We are going to talk about building simulating applications in Go. So this is going to be I'm going to cover two topics here. One is understanding what is firewall, and I'm specifically talking about Linux. Linux, you have covered your Ubuntu, Debian, CentOS, Fedora, everything. Windows is a little different paradigm, so that I'm not touching here because it will take forever to complete that. And how to build a firewall application using Golang. Golang is a tool that we are using to build it. Am I audible right? Fine, right? If I'm going too fast, please just let me do that. My name is Ashwari Paliwal. I am a cybersecurity evangelist. I work as a consultant and I've been helping companies secure their infrastructure, to perform pen testing and stuff. These are my credentials. And you know, if you guys want to collaborate sometime just for a discussion over a coffee or understand, if you really need cybersecurity and if you need what kind of services do you need, maybe you should reach out to me. So, I realized in my previous polling sessions that all of them are used to how to build a Golang project. They are just coming here to understand what this whole thing is about. So I just would like to know first, how many of you are like extremely new and never really tried any hand with Golang? Can you just raise your hand? Okay. And people who have used it in production, like currently they are working on it and using it in production. Okay, cool. So since there are a little people who here who have no idea, I'll just take 5 minutes to just give you a glimpse of what in general a Golang application is. Because if I immediately dive into what firewalling is, you people might not be able to connect. So just taking 5 minutes. For those of you who know, just please be patient with me. This is the agenda for the today. We'll be talking about what is firewalling application. We'll be discussing about how to scale it up. So I have built this application for my previous company, where we were working on building applications that would work with about 1,000 servers. So that is an issue we faced. How did we overcome that? And then how firewalling principle changes when it comes to microservices. By microservices here, I'm talking about Docker Swarm, and Kubernetes, and even the resource and the other stuff, equal thing is applicable here. Okay? So for those who are new to Golang, these are some of the pointers why somebody would choose Golang. Like, these are very standard pointers. It runs directly on hardware, compiles on machine code. It compiles into a single binary. So those of you who have been working with Python, you have to, you have to use some kind of other services to make it a binary, otherwise you just simply run a script. So that doesn't happen. Making a binary has its own advantages, some security advantages as well. Fast compilation, bootup, it's concurrent. We have been discussing like concurrency and Golang go hand in hand. That is the reason everybody is using it. That is its biggest advantage. Cross-platform support, static type system, and growing community. It is developed by Google, supported by Google, Uber, Gojek, and most of them are using it. Even now, Razorback said that they are using it. So it is a tech that is being used and it is constantly being adopted. Just one pointer here that I have noticed is that Golang is particularly famous for network-specific applications. That's what I have noticed. Even if you go in GitHub, the most starred projects or the most followed projects will be related to networking, and it is primarily because of its speed at concurrency. That has been my observation. Please feel free to refer if you think I'm wrong here. So this is the general Go directory structure. So this is how you have to create your GoLive project. Go wherever you install GoPath, there will be src, github.com, username, then your project name, and then that's how you'll be able to build your thing seamlessly. You can manipulate this, but then then you'll have to connect the direct path and everything. That will be a little cumbersome. So just follow this, and you can build a simple application very quickly. This is how a simplest of simple hello world.go looks like. Just put it in the this under project name, just do go build, then it will build up iterate and then you can run that. That's it. So that was for the people who were not aware of what GoLang, how does it work. Now coming to firewall. So in Linux, there is this thing called netfilters, okay? And netfilter has one utility called IP tables. IP tables is used so commonly that a lot of people consider netfilter and IP table to be a synonym, which is not. Netfilter has other components to it, but IP table is the most commonly used. So in IP tables, IP table is where we'll be doing most of our work, where we'll be adding our rules to essentially block any IP, any port, any subnet, and likes of it. So IP table has three types of table: filter table, NAT, and MANTL. Filter table is for packet forwarding. It relates to to handle packet forwarding. Packet forwarding is essentially connection, inbound connection, outbound connection. If I'm trying to connect to your server, that is basically I'm sending a packet to connect to you. Similarly, if you are sending me a response, you're sending me the response back through a packet. So that's what filter table handles. NAT table does the work of address translation, and MANTL table is used to manipulate your packet headers. Right now you will be only concerned with filter table because that is what all is needed for a simple firewall application, but these two are a part of it and I thought you should know, that's why I've put it. For MANTL table, basically you can manipulate your header to have a TTL timeout for your packets and the likes of it. So this is what a filter table looks like. IP table, and in that filter table looks like. This would be done in any Linux system. You can build up in yours. Just go to root. It needs root access. Just type this IP tables minus T filter minus M. So these are some of the chains which are there. I'll explain you what the chains are. So this is what a simple Linux system with nothing installed on it, no microservices. Right? If that is installed on your system, there will be a different things that I'll talk about. So yeah. So in this, if you see, there are three chains: input chain, output. Are you guys with me? Am I going too fast? It's fine. Right? So there are three chains: input, forward, and output. Input chain, as I just explained, a packet coming into my system, a request coming into my system. Everything is handled at input. Output, I'm sending it outside. Forward is, a lot of times you reroute your traffic within your system. Say, I have opened my port 80, but actually where the whole application will be served is at port 8000. So what I'll do internally is, I'll forward whatever request is coming to 80, I'll forward it to 8000. It is like you're forwarding your call, right? You set it to a different number. So a call comes to that number, but it gets forwarded to a different call. Similar thing is happening here. So that's what forward chain is supposed to do. So for inbound rules means whatever is coming into my system, I want to block that. I want to block any input, any inbound connection. Basically, we do this essentially for the bad guys. So there is this list of bad IPs, more specifically generating from China and Ukraine and likes of it, who keeps on running their crawls to detect if some kind of server is running. These are like crawlers all around. So constantly the website is published as a list of blacklist IP. So you have to put all of them here. And this is a generic syntax for it. IP tables minus A input, minus A is append. Input means input chain. Then there is I is for interface. P, so you can block TCP as well as UDP port here. the destination port, IP address, and drop. Drop means block it. Similarly, what you can do is, it's my internal network. I don't want to block hundreds of it, I just want to allow 5 of it. So what I will do is, instead of drop, I'll add accept. So basically, it will only accept connection from that particular IP and not accept from any other IP. So this is the basic, there are the terms of syntax for it, but this is the very basic, then I'll help you get started on it. So the first one talks about IP address, other is IP subnet here. And not all of it is compulsory. I can block an entire IP, I can block a particular port on an IP, I can block a particular port on an IP on a particular interface. So that is the flexibility you get. So that was for inbound. Same goes for outbound. Outbound rules means your connection is going outside. So you don't want to block that. You are allowing to receive a connection, but you don't want to respond to it. So that is outbound. That's like WhatsApp problem. So yeah, similar. Demo time. So I apologize. Actually, I had set up the entire demo, but from morning my VPN is not working. So I'll just show you the code and I'll tell you what it is supposed to do.
So here is my. Are you able to see?
Yeah.
Is it too big? Yeah, so this is like the very basic how do you create an API request. What I was trying to do here was create an API so that, you know, I'll send my IP address, port, and whatever inbound or outbound, and it will put it in my server that just block this IP on this port. That was the simple demo I was trying to do. So for those who don't know how to create APIs, this is the, like the very, very easiest way to do it in Golang. You just use this Gorilla Box. And here was my handler function, ipdemo.add. It was running on my local 8080, and yeah, that's what I was doing. Let me show you the this one. Right. So there is this great library for IP tables. This is what I have been using. So let me also talk about why you should use. So you must have used it. These are all Linux, right? By the time I told you. So why should we use a Golang library rather than directly executing a shell command through Golang? You can do that as well. So would you like to come in here? That why would I prefer to use a Golang library rather than just invoking a shell within my program and directly calling that IP table syntax? But OS API will anyway call when I invoke a shell, right? I mean, that is that library. Is my question understood? Coding principles that come into that. That is actually very right. And to add on to it, what happened to the answer? Anybody else wanted to say? Yeah.
I
can
do the flexibility. Then I the flexibility of writing programming language. Can also write into shells. But again, you know, like shell scripts are not very flexible. Writing a program is
I agree with you. Shell scripting is kind of a little weird if you are used to programming.
Actually, you can switch the IP tables command on the system and you can get a different
I can choose the IP table command on the system.
Okay. That's one of the reasons why you don't invoke shell commands.
Yeah.
And then actually go if it was the library or it does anyone commands.
Yeah, it will renew what essentially. So one of the things that happens is that so this is a very common problem
something that happens with Python programmers. And even I saw this in GoLang. So what happens is if you use directly, invoke directly a shell command, right, from here. So what will happen is it will go out of the local scope of your program. It will start interfering directly with your C because I am calling a shell script outside. So it is going out of its own local scope of your GoLang program and invoking it from somewhere else. So that could, so when these type of calls are happening, that becomes a very big security hazard. That's why you should have these, you should use these libraries even if you want to invoke any shell command so that the entire thing stays within the local scope. So yeah, that was one thing I wanted to cover there. Coming back to IP table act. So this is the main function. So this is my struct. That's how it looks like. Simple, very simple IP port and direction. IP direction is your inbound, outbound, or forward chain could be that. And just invoking an IP table function. Basic, yeah, whatever rule direction it is. And then IP table append. Filter is the table within the IP table, which I had explained. Then the chain could be input, output. Minus this is for IP. So this is if I have not given any port, and this is if I have given any port. And yeah, that's it. The IP address gets blocked successfully. I have this working demo, but unfortunately it's not working today. So I apologize. So yeah. So that was the basic of IP table. How do you block it? You could, it is beneficial if you have, you know, 10 IPs or 20 IPs coming daily. I could just run the script and things can be done. But what if you want to scale your system? What if you have about a million of IPs that you want to set? Now what happens is when you set up a rule in IP table, like let me just go back to this one. See, whenever you set up a rule will come here. And another rule will sit on top of it. So if he wants to block it, he will search top down. Okay, it's a top down search to understand whether, you know, this IP exists or not. Now what happens if you have a million IPs? If you have a million IPs, this whole thing becomes very slow because it will have to do a whole top-down search. It's a linear search. So since you can do that, that's when IPset comes into picture. IPset is an extended functionality for IP table. For very basic understanding, just map it to your hash map. Your hash map and IPset are the same thing. If you want to understand what data structure is used here. So since you must be aware that hash map has theoretically a lookup type of O(O)(1). I'm not considering the collision at all. It has a theoretical lookup type of O(O)(1). So what you do is, you add an IP set. In IP set, you can keep on adding your rules. And then you call that one IP set, only that one IP set in your IP name. So this looks like this. I created my new IP set. My name is MySet. I added two rules, 111 IP, 222 IP, and then I just called it once. So for one rule, just one rule, I'm able to cover everything. So this is how we initially fought the problem of, you know, the large scale issue that we were facing. And IPset has another advantage that, you know, it helps you to organize things in a better way. Because here, this could be specific to a company, specific to a particular organization. I could have that name, and then correspondingly, I can put it in my set. In just IP levels, I would not know which guy has put the rules for what purpose. So it also helps in organizing, but more so in your efficiency. Now, there has been a study on IPset, which states that post 10 million, this also fails. This also starts to slow down. So in those cases, people have been experimenting around with what are called as probabilistic data structures. I'm not sure how many of you have heard of it. So these so one of the most famous that's being used here is called is Bloom filters. So Bloom filters can essentially help you to mitigate that kind of a scale if you have that. And that kind of scale exists for large banks. Say, IIB, Investment Bank, or SBI Bank. So I have firsthand seen the scenarios where even IPset would fail to scale up. So there you would use Bloom filters. But the problem is that since they are probabilistic data structures, so there are sometimes a few false positives. So yeah, that is one issue, but then that's the only way right now we have for scaling. And see, these are a couple of IP set types. So in my example, what you saw, in my example, what you saw was simple hash IP. That's only IP, not even a port. But here you can see IP. So this is what I used. And there are a bunch of the types that you can use here. Also, you can also customize for your own data structure. So that is another thing. Coming to firewalling and microservices. So far with me, guys, or is it boring? What if you have, you are not sure of the range of particular IP? If it's a rotatable IPs, right? People do that. So I throw IPs from various different regions of the world. So how will you be able to block that? And if I'm a company, say I am Amazon.com. So my target is the whole world. So I don't want to block any particular country, right? So yeah, that's why you can't use that. But yeah, it depends on the use case. So I like that. It depends on the use case. If you are a very localized company, you are running only in Bangalore, then yeah, you should use that. So everybody with me so far? Is it too boring? Yeah. So for firewalling with microservices. So what happens is that how many of you have some idea of using Docker Kubernetes, or are you using them? Can we have a show of hands for that? Oh, awesome. So what happens is, if you install Docker Kubernetes, they add their own set of rules to it, because essentially they are orchestration service. Their job is to orchestrate your traffic, orchestrate service. Basically, what is it orchestrating? It is orchestrating the whole network connection. So it adds a lot more rules to your IP tables. So I had a better demo for it, but now right now I just have one. I'll show you. So yeah. So if you get this, so just a second. So if you see, so the previous one that I showed you had only three chains. Now it has Docker isolation, something related to established, and yeah, these kind of things. So and with Docker there are a few changes. With Kubernetes it adds about more than 8 changes, and if you have resource then it adds its own changes. So it keeps going on and on. So in this case, what you have to when it comes to these changes, you have to be a little careful because previously we were appending the new rules. If you append the new rules, the way Kubernetes and Dockers are built, they will override your rule, because they always want their rule to be the first one to run. Otherwise, the whole system might not work correctly. So in those cases, you have to be particularly careful. First is, you have to ensure that your rule sits on the very top of the table. If it does not sit on the very top of the table, there is a good chance your rule will not even work, because the other rule might show. Because since IP table works top down, it will, if first the IC is drop it, other if second IC is accepted, it will just drop it. So it is important to work to look into that. Huh? And another part is understanding of services. So the forward chain part. So almost every service that is running in Kubernetes, any service, is by default forwarded to a different port. They run there. So it has created, Docker and Kubernetes have created their own virtualized session within it. So they will always forward your direct port to the Docker port, and then they will forward the your packet. So in that case, it is also very important to take care that whatever is being forwarded, you put it in the forward chain. Even it may feel like it is an inbound connection coming directly to your port, it's not directly coming to your port. You have to block it at the forward chain. So those are the couple of things with this. And yeah, congratulations, you made it to that. I was in both of the states, so that's a good thing. So any questions so far? Yeah.
Okay.
and then get the packets out of it and then use that instead. You know, just in case if we have an environment where we don't have library tables there. We, since the book goes that way, and since the traffic is more cross-platform. So that's the question.
So sniffing a traffic is totally different job. You use intrusion prevention system for that. You can build using it. But their work is very different. To sniff a traffic and to identify it is bad. There is whole band of different engineering that needs to be done. So the purpose of this is that I already know that this guy. To sniff a traffic means I am not yet sure if he is good or bad. So that is this is like the final wall, you can say, or the last security layer. That even if it hits here, it's blocked. What you are saying is more of a detection of a thing, whether this is good or bad. So that is a whole. So there are a lot of you can read about IPS and IDS systems. So they exactly do that. Okay, like Suricata is one such famous project that if you want, you can look it up. It does exactly what you are saying.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
What if we want to block a CIDR block?
Yeah, that is also possible in this. If you go to high tables, right? It has a syntax for that. Yeah, it has. It is quite flexible. Both of them are quite flexible. Because of the space, I can put everything, but
does IP tables also work with IPv6?
Yeah, IP tables work with IPv6 as well.
Okay. So, some funny question. So, let's say if you don't have. So, let's say the net filter subsystem is not providing ABS for to interact with the system. So, using Go, will you be still able to build a firewall application without using net filter subsystem?
If it is not having to use your subsystem, you're saying.
So your net filter subsystem, you are using all the APIs provided by the net filter subsystem.
Right.
So if net filter subsystem is not providing any such APIs, will you still be able to use Go and build such
application? If net filter is not providing such an API, I'm we were discussing with SDO, how will it even accept our connection? Like, if that thing doesn't exist in its host space, So I'm just wondering, will it even be able to accept the connection? The whole network layer, wouldn't that break if that API service is not available? So the L3 layer, when we talk about it, OSM,
yeah. Yeah, you're right. Actually, for you to write your own program, it will have to run as root because IPTV is actually messing with the routing templates. We will need to be a replacement for the routing template.
I'm not that familiar with networking and stuff, so I'm just curious. So we are like working exclusively with IP tables command, right? So are there any APIs or like a similar command in like Windows or any other operating system that Go supports?
No, so because these basically are down to the network layer, it cannot be seen. For Linux, it is common. For any distribution you see, it's common. For Windows, what you have is ADB firewall. That's what you use. You can set it up using NetSH command.
Okay.
And actually, Windows is quite easy to do that. They have a cool GUI and all, and you can automate it. But you cannot have one program that does the both.
Okay. And the second question is like the program that we wrote is cross platform. Like if I compile it with Windows, will it run?
The whole network,
yeah,
it's cross.
I mean,
as long as you're using NetFilter for functionality, it is not cross platform on any Linux system. So that is the feature of Go actually.
You know, I'm asking, like, we were discussing the reasons that we use the package, the Core OS stuff. So the reason was
the reason why we use package is because when the program is run, if I'm invoking a shell script from the outside, basically then I'm going out of the local scope of the program. So invoking something from the outside is not considered a safe practice because that could result in some malicious program intruding in between and corrupting my system. That's okay. Why you want to stay within the global scope of it.
Yeah, that's right. Also, I'm feeling like, if we are using IP tables directly,
from your Go program, then you are assuming that IP tables binary is actually available in your environment, right?
Yeah.
So if you are compiling it on a Windows machine, you don't have IP tables, right? So what I'm assuming is that the CoreOS library might have implemented the same functionality or the same API for a Windows-based system.
No, so Windows doesn't have IP tables.
So what I'm trying to understand is that I told that the binary will work seamlessly if I compile it and run on Windows machine, right? So
No, it will not run on Windows. You can compile already, you can code on Windows machine.
Yeah.
But it will only run on the place where IP table is there on the
Windows. Okay.
Then only run on the Windows system.
Got it.
Windows ka whole paradigm is very different from Firefox. So this whatever I've given only applies to Linux.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else? Yeah, so I said the solution that you should look forward, but if you are looking at that kind of a scale, probabilistic data structure is what people are using right now. In scenarios where you have more than 10 million of rules at one place, and then you have not organized them well, and then that's why you want to use group filters, then you'll have to use it. There's no good use case of using a probabilistic filter. There never is. It's more of a trade-off. So yeah, so even I said in the presentation that there will be few things that will be missed out. There will be a few false positives. So that will be missed out, but you can't do anything about it because you are handling that kind of scheme. But it is in very, very large organizations where this comes into place, like huge banks and all. But even now, with microservices coming into picture and these things getting distributed, that issue has lessened. But for those who are interested, probabilistic data structure is what is being used. Anything else?
When you're talking about firewalls, right, we are talking about companies with network switches and the hardware appliances actually takes care of blocking all this malicious IP addresses, right? IP addresses which are coming back. And whatever code you have written here and issued is primarily for a single system, or where is it that you basically implement this stuff? Because this spoke about scaling it up with 1,000 systems. So how is it that you are implemented and spend more about it?
So the reason for me to tell you this was that, so you said that there are firewalling applications that you use at your organization's operating system, like Windows.
You can ask me if Firewall gives you a firewall.
Yeah, it gives you a firewall, but so there are these IPs, Talcos, Intelligence, and you can go and look it up. So they throw a new list of about 1,000 IPs daily for blacklisted. Mm-hmm. So how do you add that continuously in your system? So you need a programmatic way to continuously add that in your system. And Windows does give it, but my added experience here was to tell you how essentially these applications work. And if you want, so we wanted to create an application because we were working from cloud security, we were building a cloud security platform, and we wanted to have this feature. So that's how we build it. So if you want to build it for your product, you can build it this way. Like if you want to have it in-house. Yeah, it's not a replacement, like it's not a replacement for that. It is the way you build a firewall.
Just to explain, so what we said in the we were discussing. So you mentioned that, there are companies which sends, list of IPs which are, have some vulnerability issues, so normally, how it happens, because I'm not from the networking background. So how normally it happens, because these are all rule based, right? For say a bank, these are all rule based. So the rule engine will run, and when the request from an IP comes, right, normally. So is it that there is going to be a separate table where those list of block IPs are maintained, and then there is a lookup that is done to see whether those are part of any of this, that IP, incoming IP, the request from the IPs, part of any of the blocked sites or blocked, you know, yeah.
This IP table is that table.
Okay.
Which does not look up. This is exactly what you do if you have a Linux system. This is exactly where you store all the rules. You can use any professional solution for it, but it eventually uses this. So this is where you look it up, and that's where when you want to scale it, you will not find rules within the IP table, you will find them inside the IP set, and they are being called inside here. So that is how it works. I hope I have
it. Yeah, yeah, thank you.
One more question, right? You mentioned about this IP table, right? And it's basically almost like a text file, right? Which basically gets scanned sequentially each and every IP address with a block or not block, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, when there are millions of records, you spoke about IPsec, right? I'm still trying to figure out for a single system, right? Maybe a Linux machine or something. What type of mechanism, how do you basically do so many buckets coming, so much amount of network traffic gets shipped out of your system, right? How is it that you're doing a parallel thing like so many network, so much of network traffic is there, and how do you filter out the IP address? How do you decide when which is not to block, right? Would that pre traversal or scanning through the entire sequence of IP addresses, would you think the system would become slow?
So no, that is what netfilter does. Whenever traffic comes into your system, even if you have IPsec rules added or not, it will run through IPsec. That is how the whole the packet coming in works. It has to go through that routing. So when it goes through that routing table, you tell them to block this. And since you mentioned the millions, that's why we use this whole IPsec, because it has hash data structure and lookup is over. Yeah, it has, so yeah, giving this back into simple hash. It is like almost equivalent to that. So it has a theoretical lookup of over one, and then you can quickly look it up that, you know, this is, should I allow it?
Okay.
Anything else?
Yeah. Does that library also use the IP tables binary?
Which time?
The Golang library you were using?
I'm not.
Because if it uses that, doesn't that also will go out of the local scope of the binary?
Right. I'm not sure on that part. I agree with you on that. I have to look it up and then maybe I'll.
So then that was the.
I was just thinking it was just a pure file open or file close for IP table, right? When it's making entry for. It's basically adding an entry, appending an entry there. It's not actually manipulating, it's not coming to a shell and executing a command or something.
It is actually opening executing a shell command, which is not ideal. So the Go IP tables library is actually just a wrapper which also runs a command.cmd and with Linux shell. So it's just a wrapper around the IP tables command. And the IP tables library as such, the documentation in the IP tables library says that you should not be invoking EPAs in the event, because it's likely that they might break. So they're not guaranteeing that, it doesn't say that. It doesn't say that.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So if that is the case, if it's invoking a shell command, then it's not right. But essentially, you should do is invoke or use a Golang command to invoke shell within the program, and then run this your rule chain syntax, whatever. That is the ideal scenario. I was not aware of this, but yeah, that is the ideal scenario how you should do it.
First, we will try to sanitize the IP table command itself. And before you run the IP table command, you check the hash, verify it against the node. Because there are ways in which you can easily, if you have access to the user context in which you are running this binary, you can easily insert your own bash file called IP tables. As long as it's in the path, the IP tables it's going to find is the one that you committed to. Right? And you can make it to run the actual IP tables command, which will be an SP binary. The other point you mentioned, I have some experience on that also. So you are right that actually there can be a performance penalty. But you optimize it based on the order of the rules. Because any IP table is really, really fast. But if you write rules which specifically have weight, then they can go in the wrong sequence. If you spend a lot of Docker containers on a very high system, with its independent company network, then it is going to be inside more and more equitable. The way to optimize it is you need to optimize the rules that are present. So you can resequence them to make it more performant. So basically you put all the blocking rules on top and then all the processing rules on top. So it unnecessarily packets are going through every single put it in some sort of plan.
Anything else, guys? Okay, so yeah, so that's it from my side today. And if you guys want to talk more about security, networking, and all, I'm around, so please feel free to come and have a chat with me. And yeah, thank you so much for being a good audience. Thank you.
Also, we talked about security performance, right? There is EDR filters connected. So if you want to bypass this entire net filter, then you can go with the EDR. It's much more performant. But yes, there are, if you have worked with the sidecar, filter fan, not V, right? On the Kubernetes, they are directly using EBF in the Linux kernel. So yes, so from a performance perspective, EBF is much faster. But it will take time since this becomes mainstream in the Linux. No, EBF was there, so that's how you actually do the wire circ actually work, right? It injects the EBF hook inside your kernel, but it was not widely accepted or adopted. Adopted because not every kernel hook was available. Now kernel has so many hooks that you can do all those kind of weird stuff. Also, you can actually filter out packets. You can get the process. It starts much faster without being dependent on the OS direct line or a system call. So it's been adopted now in much a faster way. And plus, it gives you much faster flexibility. Not faster, it gives you much flexibility to directly inject your code inside the kernel without being without hacking the operating system. Yes, it runs, but it runs at the layer, different layer thing, right? You have to, plus these things still becomes the, okay. So when your packets comes in, right? He was saying we have to, you know, your application, I can write an application and do the same thing. Yes, you can write your application and do the same thing, but these things happens at the kernel level, right? If you are doing this in the, your application, your this network traffic comes at the application level. And basically you are open to so many other vulnerabilities. Sync flooding is one of them, right? Sync flood, right? Operating system means your web server does not acknowledge do the sync part. It is taken care by the operating system, right? You do the sync call, it checks if the there is enough queue level, depth level, and then uses sync acknowledgement and then sync acknowledgement, and then the web server accepts the connection. So those are other part also you have to take care. And plus, if you are parsing it at your level, means if I have to drop the packet, sooner I drop, it's better, right? At the kernel level, all I have to do is figure out that, okay, I will frame comes in, next layer, what is the next layer? Frame comes in, I will just figure out the IP layer packet. Above that, we have the TCP layer, right? Where at the TCP layer, I will figure out the ports. So I just drop by the IP layer, I don't even drop, figure out the port TCP layer. I avoided so many things, means TCP header parsing, all those header parsing. And it does not matter if I have received all the packets or not. With one header, I can drop the entire sequence of packets. So those are the other performance benefits application wise where to use it. If you are writing your own sidecar, anyone sidecar pattern, right? How does it work? There is an init container inside every sidecar. There is an init container that is being called first, and it actually hijacks all your connections, right? Request
and it puts it through the whatever site inbound proxy you are using or anything you are using. It puts all the forward, all the connection to those containers, and then it goes to your application. So it's basically a forward chain rule inside the. You can search for that's how Istio and LinkedIn works. That's the basic fundamental of any site. Otherwise, I mean, there is no other way currently apart from VU that is doing the VPN filters. Any questions? Okay. Thank you everyone for attending. I hope you enjoyed it. Just some bookkeeping stuff. We are also, those who have not joined Bangalore, Google and Bangalore meetup page, please join. We do post event over here only. There is no other platform that we keep track of right now. There is a Gopher Slack channel, and inside that there is a Bangalore channel. You can join that also. And we will I will be posting the link for the job requirements, all the job requirements that has been in the meetup 53. And also you can check the same. I will post the blog post also with Satish has wrote about how to, you know, going forward, you can clone that meetup job template and send it to him. We will be displaying the job over there. If we also have Golang India GitHub page. Here we in the Golang Bangalore meetup, we have the host requirement. Yes, we are completely volunteer driven meetup. We look forward to, as it means, from the company as a to host us. We also look forward to you guys to come and help us in organizing these events, because we don't own, nobody owns the Golang Bangalore meetup. It's completely volunteer driven. And if you have any question, I am available in both the Slack channels and all, and I am also available on the Twitter handle. So if you have anything, feel free to tag me anywhere. I will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you. And at the end, not the least, we have this feedback. Just sticking out, please write your feedback and give it to us. It's helpful for us. It's over here with the pen, please. Thank you so much for coming. Hope to see you in the next meeting. Anything you would like to add?
Please ensure that you fill your feedback before you leave. Another thing is, we are currently four co-organizers of Golang Bangalore. We sort of do this on rotation. Different people are active at different times. And we are actually still looking out for more volunteers. So if any of you work on Go a lot, and are interested in volunteering in helping this community, please come and meet us. We'll be here after this meetup too. So just feel free to come and meet. So the difficulties we generally face are if one of us is traveling outside or going out or traveling in between or attend or giving the talk at a different conference, it is hard for them to also meet up here. That tends to happen a lot. Also, Ankur and I have been part of this organizing committee for about a year and a half. I am actually pursuing some higher studies, so my weekends are also tight from March onwards. So if any of you are interested, please do come forward. Any time you can spare will be recording. Thanks. And we'll ensure that we can guide you through all the steps, whatever you need to know about it, that we'll be there to help you. You will not be the only person doing it. We are a team of four people now, and there are a couple of more people who are all part of the community, who are ex-organizers, who are also part of the discussions that we have in terms of what we are doing and so on. So there is a group of 6 to 7 people. There are two more issues that have been handled. One is a group of women who are part of the women. That was the most awesome. And we like to ensure that dates work on it, so you can mention it. We are looking for more participants. So we are looking for people from the ideas which they want to present. It's a fully interactive environment. We do it on Zoom.
So you have a great facility of showing security and walking team walking through the board. And that way, very again, and very second return engagement compared to the top format that you do over there. So, but we are looking for a big amount of the ideas or any techniques that you might be working with on a digital business, which you can do. Which are like, feel free to pitch in for that. If you're unsure, then feel free to come talk to us. We will tell you whether it is good for talk or good for the project to if you have any questions that you might have, especially if you can on Slack, meet up with me, you can find us here. Feel free to talk to us. Thanks. Please, again, please fill your feedback forms. It is very useful to us because we take this feedback and we take comments to video experience that we need to do. And we can see a lot of the video experience. So, generally, we don't collect any information that is private to you. We don't collect all the books or their ideas and things like that. So, but your feedback will be very good. Thank you. Thank you.